Welcome to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Vagha Mouradian here at the Association of the United States Army's annual meeting and trade show in Washington, D.C. Our coverage here is sponsored by AM General, Elbit Systems of America, General Motors Hydrotech, L3 Technologies, and Leonardo DRS. And we're over here at Bell Helicopter, where we're talking to Mitch Snyder, who's the president and CEO of Bell. Bell Helicopter is also a sponsor of our weekly Defense and Aerospace Business Report podcast. Mitch, great seeing you.
It's great meeting you, and great seeing you, too.
Thanks very much for making time in your schedule. I know how busy you were. You were talking to your CEO a minute ago, and you've got the Army customer all over you. Thanks very much for the time.
No, I appreciate you being here, and I look forward to the discussion.
So I wanted to start off. You know, you guys have made a big investment in the V-280 Valor. That's going to be your submission into the Army's long-running competition in order to develop its next future vertical lift solution. Bring us up to speed on the program. You know, you guys made quite a bang a few years ago by bringing the mock-up. You've brought the model every year, but now there's an actual machine that's going through testing. Bring us up to speed on where you are on the program.
You know, it's been fantastic. You know, back in 2013, we set the marker and said, hey, you know, we're going to go develop this aircraft and meet all of our major milestones. And, you know, in September of 2017, we should be near first flight. And, you know, lo and behold, we've met all of our milestones. We've been on schedule and cost. And, you know, it's been an internal investment. With some external Army funding, but we've been on schedule and cost to get there. And as you can hear above us, the rotors are turning. So it's been fantastic to say in 4 years we're going to be to this date, and we hit that date, rotors are turning, we should be flying soon this fall.
What sort of an aggressive test schedule are you guys looking at? You know, at what point do you want to, you know, walk us through what happens, you know, after that first flight happens and you look forward, because you guys are also doing a lot of production engineering. You're looking at what happens if you win this program, because once it's going to be a long process, but once it starts, it's actually going to go, because now it's the Army's third highest priority.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And so as far as the test program goes, you know, we're going to start off with our hovering flight, and then we'll go into conversion to full airplane mode. The aircraft will transition back to Fort Worth, where we do most of our test flying. And we've got a rigorous test program to expand the envelope and hit all the corners, and ultimately demonstrate that that aircraft, and that's why we call it a prototype, that will do the exact mission that the Army is intending it to do. So we'll get that done. I also wanted to show within the next year also that we'll have the aircraft fly unmanned. So it's set up as optionally piloted, so in addition to the test schedule there, we'll have the aircraft go off and fly a mission by itself.
And is that a requirement in the program, or is that something you guys are doing?
Yes, sir. Optionally pilot is part of the requirement. We want to demonstrate again with our prototype that we can actually meet that. Now, in follow on to your question, in addition, what else are we doing? Well, so there's some technologies that are not in the prototype that we're continuing to do research and development on to make sure that they're all at TRL level 6 to be in our proposal. In addition, we've started looking at how we would actually manufacture the aircraft. You know, the interesting thing, being a prototype, we actually did time studies, measured how long it was to build this. We use the same manufacturing techniques that we'd like to use in production. So again, we feel very confident going into the build of the aircraft and submitting our proposals that we know how it's going to fly, it meets the requirements, and how we will manufacture the aircraft to meet those rigorous cost targets.
Some of the folks who are in this competition like to point out that the Army is looking for a fast helicopter, and they differentiate that they're not looking for a tilt rotor. Do you guys face an uphill challenge in making the case do you feel you have an uphill challenge at all in making the case for the tilt rotor in something, you know, given that the Army's experience has been with helicopters, right? You're pushing on an open door when it comes to the Marine Corps and to the Air Force and to the Navy, who decided to replace the COD with the V-22. Do you face a little bit of an uphill challenge with the Army on that?
You know, I think we've made tremendous progress there. You know, in addition, like you said, we built the mock-up, but we also built a simulator and put the actual flight controls, flight simulation, the way it's going to fly in that simulator. And the other thing we did, we knew the Army wanted more agility, what they call agility at the X. So there's twice as much agility in this aircraft built into the flapping. So this aircraft is going to be much more agile than a V-22. So we've embedded that in the simulators. We've been having pilots come in and fly the simulator. And of course, when they walk out, they go, if that aircraft flies like that simulator, that's going to be fantastic. Also, as part of the test program, they've had Army experimental pilots are going to be flying this V-280 aircraft. They've already gone through V-22 training. And the initial feedback they got out of the aircraft was the V-22 is a lot more agile than we thought it was. So I think slowly we're knocking down those barriers, and the Army is definitely willing to look at the tilt rotor.
One of the Everybody is talking about the word affordable, right? That this has to be an affordable vertical lift solution. Yep. As the CEO of the company, what does that mean to you? I mean, you know, is it affordable in purchasing cost? I mean, the Marine Corps looks at, for example, the V-22. Yes, it's got a much higher purchase price than a helicopter, but they're looking at it and saying, okay, well, it's faster, it carries more cargo further, right. Farther, so it changes the dynamic of whatever your traditional metric would be. So as you look at the word affordable, I mean, what does that mean for you?
Okay, there's lots of things with that. And I'll say that affordability for me, specifically looking at the aircraft, is first its unit acquisition price, as well as its operational costs. So when you look at that, we said, hey, you know, when we targeted this, nobody questions the speed, the range, the capabilities of a tilt rotor. What they come back and always challenge us with is, what does it cost to do it? So we've said, hey, unit cost for this is going to be less than half the price of a V-22. So we targeted very, very strict numbers there, and that was one of our top key performance parameters, is meeting that cost target. And lo and behold, as we've went through this process, and the simplicity of our design was to meet those, and we've been very close all the way through this, probably within 5% of our original target price, we've hit it. And so that's felt really good. On the operational costs, it was designed in to have more reliability and maintainability into it. We learned lessons from those 400,000 hours on the V-22. So that's all incorporated. Most of the cost is in the nacelles. 60% of the ONS is in those nacelles. And so the redesign nacelles around that affordability is in there. So we believe we're going to hit those costs as well as the ONS costs. And then another thing that you really have to consider is the mission costs. So again, if you look at the speed and range, you know, they have to, in the field, when they set up forward refueling points with soldiers guarding those refueling points to get the helicopters to be able to move across the battlefield, you don't need those with a tilt rotor. So there's an even advantage with total mission costs. But what I was focused on is what we can control. And what we can control is most of the cost of an aircraft is designed in. So we're focused on acquisition costs and ONS costs.
You guys, though, when it comes to your commercial products, and also on the defense side, have been making a lot of investment to fundamentally change manufacturing, and you're using better materials, you'll need fewer fasteners. That drives a whole revolution in how you approach that. Virtual reality technology is changing the game in laying systems out for accessibility and serviceability. Yeah. But some of the certification standards are a little bit antiquated and don't necessarily accommodate for that. So there's a lot of effort you guys have to put in to do certain things certain ways, because that's how the whole organism deals with it, whether it's from a defense cost management standpoint or anything else. What are some of the changes that you think, because there's such a revolution going on in production and in materials and in design, how do you think the acquisition system should change as a result of that? Fundamental, or even the certification system, yeah. You know, in the Navy context, you know, it's like, well, we bolt things to the deck with X number of bolts because that's how we've done it. Well, yeah. Actually, with newer technology and everything else, you might not need 21 bolts to do that. And that's the same for aircraft design. What are some changes you think that could happen on that that is good for you, but also good for the customer ultimately?
So I think the real biggest thing that we've seen, and you know, it's funny when the Army comes out and visits and takes a look at the aircraft, they're just as impressed with the digital design that we've done, we call it the digital thread. But it's really the data design that we've done and the CATIA V6 we've used, along with the Innova data management system. Between those two elements, the aircraft actually goes together perfectly the way we designed it. The other thing that we did different is we did a design as built. So normally you design the structure and then you figure out how to get the wiring done and the fuel and all the same. And we actually said, no, we're going to design it as we build it. So we actually lay out how we're going to build the aircraft and then design it that way. So that design to build process, along with those new digital tools, has really changed the way that you can build the aircraft. The other extremely important thing about that is there's no really data packages and seed rules anymore. It's all electronic. So I think we can bring that to the Army and any military service. That's going to be different, and it's something they're not used to, so we're really educating on them. But what was great for us is they were more excited about that too. They were really saying, wow. You know, like for example, when you do design reviews, we're in there in our design space designing. They come online, join in with us, and they actually can see the designs as we're designing them in our space. They can look at our data management system and get inside it with us. It's not this serial of, let's design it, build it in paper, hand it to them, have them review it, get back to us. So we really believe we can cut down the acquisition time and the data management. It really does transition to the next level too, because we can use that. We built the aircraft off iPads right. In Amarillo. That can go into the maintaining side here. We're demonstrating here at the show goggles, how you can actually put goggles on and look through the aircraft and components and get messages online looking through the glasses of how to maintain the aircraft. It's all in the digital thread.
Right. And it's a model-based design, right? I mean, that's the big...
It goes together perfectly.
Let me take you to a statement you made yesterday. You were on a panel discussion. You were asked an impromptu question about how you would grade what it's like to do business with the Army.
Yeah.
You guys do a fair amount of business.
Yeah.
And you said that it is the hardest of the services to work with.
Right.
Talk to us a little bit about that and how you feel... what the Army can do to make it an easier process.
Yeah, so I think they're already doing it. I think what they did on JMRTD, by collaboratively working with us on the requirements, that was an iterative process, industry working with the Army up front on what should the requirements be, what is the capability of technology that we can bring to those requirements, because usually when you start requirements, it's pretty broad and demanding, and there's no real, is the technology ready? Do you really understand what that's going to cost if you have us do those kind of things? So that collaboration really honed us in on some requirements that we were able to do. So I think starting there and then prototyping and building technology demonstrations that show, hey, that is the art of the possible. We can make it real for you. So then when they move into the acquisition side of it on future vertical lift, they're very informed. They know the technology is at the readiness levels it needs to be, and they can move forward with the acquisition. So I really believe that they've already transitioned to make it easier, and that easier part of it was really collaborating with industry.
What do you think the Army can learn from your guys' supplier management systems? I mean, each one of the commercial contractors is managing a vast, and you guys are making all sorts of industrial-based decisions for critical suppliers.
Yep.
You're willing to give them a hand, make sure that they're level loaded, even if that puts pressure on your bottom line to make sure that they're there when you're going to ramp up.
Yep.
What are some of the things that the government can learn about how industry manages its supply chains?
Well, we treat our supply base as partners and teammates. And I think when you do that and you figure out, even on V-280 here, what we did was we had investing teammates with us. Each area that they have is what they invest in and what they specialize in. So we leveraged their capabilities in that supply base and brought that forward to us. And also when you're investing, you're in the game. Skin's in the game with you, right, to make sure that we're doing that properly. So I think the way we treat our supply base as partners and teammates really does help that. And again, when you're looking forward as far as sustainment, because that's a really big effort of this is sustainment too. If you treat that as a partnership and you forecast properly in the future, I think that makes a big difference. You know, we've been number one in commercial support and sustainment for 23 years in a row at Bell. You know, and it's tougher for us on the military side because of the way the systems are set up. So again, I think if you let us help forecast, you help us get the supply base, because that's really what you're after is, and if there are issues, can we help design in the reliability back into the aircraft? Because that's what we do on the commercial side of the business. So it's really around the mindset of collaboration and teaming together. You can still, and I told them that yesterday on the panel, you can still have competition. You need that competition because that helps drive us. But you can be collaborative and be competitive at the same time.
Talk to us a little bit about the commercial side of the industry. You guys did make a decision a long time ago that did end up hurting you guys in the helicopter side of the business, where you lost some market share. You guys went on a big investment program a couple of years ago, developed a whole bunch of new helicopters, very highly rated, everybody liked them a lot, and then the bottom of the oil market fell out. And a lot of those were designed to support the oil and gas energy extraction industries. Talk to us a little bit about where you guys are on the commercial side and how that, you know, how are you mitigating the impact of that on the defense side, where you've got a boss and Scott's asking you for you to make your sales goals and targets.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to us about the commercial dynamic a little bit.
Sure, so you're right, we did invest and we went with two clean sheet designs for the most part, 505, an entry level market, and then 525, one of the biggest helicopters that we've ever produced. And on the 505, you know, we finished certification on it, we're ramping production. We're actually going to deliver 40 aircraft to customers this year, and we're ramping even greater next year. So that part is doing extremely well on the entry level market. On the 525, we're back in flight test again and flying there, and we hope to get certification, and probably early 19 is when that'll occur. And you know, the market is always changing. You know, right now, if I look across the whole market, it's actually stabilized. You know, from last year, it was pretty far down, and this year it's really stabilized, and in some areas, some of our models have an uptick. So we've seen and been pleasantly surprised by some of the commercial market coming back. Now, it hasn't come back in the segments that you've discussed. You know, it really hasn't come back in necessarily the oil and gas or emerging medical, but there are a lot of governments, for example, out there buying buying the helicopters. And we again, we believe when the 525 does come around in 2019, you never know what the market conditions are. But we've also been looking at a lot of requests about search and rescue. They're still looking at, we had a lot of discussions with folks in the North Sea that still want this aircraft, you know, to do North Sea and potentially deeper on the Gulf. But we believe there's a strong market there. And the good thing is our commercial market has come back.
And you're still building Hueys, so yep. You know, if anybody wants to buy one, you guys are actually have a robust production line on that.
That's correct.
One question. I mean, were you guys surprised? The Lakota has evolved into something that was originally supposed to be sort of a guard level airplane, but then it has become the Army's trainer. Were you guys surprised at how that ended up? Because you know, my understanding was always you guys were interested at least in competing for the new Army trainer competition.
Right. No, I think the thing is you know, you got to have the right product at the right time. You know, and I think at the time, you know, we were pushing a particular model. I think right now it'd be great if we go back and look. I think our 429 is a fantastic aircraft, and I think it would have competed pretty well. Back to you said, we didn't quite invest in those times, and we didn't necessarily had all the models that we wanted to have to be competitive. But we're back in investing right there. And, you know, again, if you have the requirements out there and you have the right products, you tend to sell, right? So I think the key thing is we're knowing that, we're investing, and we're going to see that commercial market turn back.
The Textron has defined itself as a company that's willing to make that investment. Is it a hard challenge for you, especially at a time of uncertain budgetary environments, to go to your boss, Scott Donnelly, and get those investment dollars to invest in something in the future, especially when the budget outlook remains murky?
No, not at all. In fact, if you look, Scott has been extremely supportive of everything we're doing. You know, to have three clean sheet designs, the investment levels that we're making in the business, like I said, we were doing the 505, the 525, and the V-280 all simultaneous, right? Now I've got V-247 that we're investing in for the MUX program. So, you know, anytime we've gone back, I show the market need, I show where the need is in the Department of Defense, and they've been giving us the investment levels. Now, having said that, I've got to deliver. And so you can see Bell's continuing to make sure that we're delivering the financials we need in order to get that investment. We're earning our investment.
And one last question. How, now that Sikorsky's part of Lockheed, as a guy who's been in the industry for a while, do you notice anything different about how Sikorsky's behaving on the market, whether it's, you know, more investment dollars, less investment dollars, more aggressive, less aggressive? Do you notice any difference in how they're behaving since you guys are you know, locked in a worldwide competition?
Right. No, I haven't. I mean, Sikorsky, yeah, they do have a different parent company. Maybe things will change over time, but right now I haven't seen any difference in how they behave.
Mitch, thanks very much for all your time. We really appreciate it and look forward to talking to you again soon.
I also feel the same. Thanks, Fago. How you doing?